don't expire is the word of God. It's forever. Power expires. There were billionaires of yesterday that their children are suffering today. Be careful what you do. Why will you give your enemy advantage and be disadvantaged in the issues of life?
Liberation glory.
You showed you can.
Come with me this morning. John chapter number 19. John chapter number 19. From verse 17. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, Eden, where they crucified him and two other with him on either side, one and Jesus in the midst. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. 20. This title then read many of the Jews. For the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city, and it was written in Hebrew and Greek and Latin. 21. Then said the chief priest of the Jews to Pilate, write not the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am King of the Jews. Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. May the Lord bless his word.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Please be seated. I want to speak to you briefly what is on the message entitled, What is Written is Written. I want to pray for somebody this morning. There is nobody in life or that can exist here on earth without a purpose. And anybody that, listen carefully as we go on, anybody that operates here on earth without a purpose is somebody that have nowhere going to. For example, the Bible said in Acts chapter 10, for how God anointed Jesus Christ with the power and with the Holy Ghost. Now, watch this, anointed, how God anointed Jesus. Now, the question is, what is the anointing for? How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the power and the Holy Ghost, which went about doing good, healing the sick, and casting out devils of them that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Now, the anointing was given, but defined. For a purpose. How I anointed Jesus. What is the purpose of the anointing? Because God does not anoint a man for the man to be using the anointing to say, oh, look, I am anointed. No. The anointing is for a purpose. For a purpose. And the purpose clearly states that he was anointed to heal the sick. And the other time in Luke chapter 4 from verse 16, he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. What is the essence of the Spirit of the Lord being upon you? He said, he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. Verse 17, watch this. Somebody say purpose. So when something is written for a purpose. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Esaias. And when he had opened the book, he found a place where it was written, where it was written, where it was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he had anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He had sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are what? Bruised. To preach the acceptable year of the Lord. 20. And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, and sat down, and the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fasting on him. 21. And he began to say unto them, this day is the scripture fulfilled in your ears. Every destiny is scriptural. This day. Now watch. For many years, Jesus was going about. But until one day, he came to the temple. Then when he opened the book, the Bible said, as it was his custom to read. And when he opened it, he began to read. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. That means I am anointed by the Spirit of the Lord. What is the purpose of the anointing? To heal the sick, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach the good news, to set free those that are kept in bondage by the enemy, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. It didn't end there. He said, today, I just discovered my destiny. And he said, before your eyes, you shall see the fulfillment of my destiny. Where did he get it from? It is written in a book. When God created you, he wrote about your destiny first. How you will function, how you will end, what you will become, and then he released you and said, go and fulfill the destiny. But some destinies, the books are still covered. I came to open it. And some what is written, the enemy has hijacked. I came to enforce it.
Amen.
What is written is written. There is no denial. It's already written, and it's too late to withdraw it. Why? Because what is written is written. It said, my word which I speak. There are two words. There are the spoken words, and there are the written words. A spoken words and the written words can convey the same language. Then somebody, a man of authority, says, hey, I demand from today that the troops be withdrawn. Because he spoke, the troops will be withdrawn. Now the man of authority also put in writing that I demand that from today, let all the troops be withdrawn. And they'll be withdrawn. Remember, David did not speak about Uriah. He wrote. And he said, take this. He gave it to Uriah. He said, give it to the commander of the army. And when he got there, what was written was executed. He said, put him in the front line where the battle is severe, where people don't succeed, survive. Then after reading the letter, he didn't hear David speak, but he read the letter, because what is written is written. It was written that you will be great. It was written that you will become somebody.
Yes, sir.
It was written that the purpose in your life will be fulfilled. But somewhat the enemy has hijacked it. I came to prophesy on somebody.
I receive.
Whatever that is written by Elohim, I declare it enforced.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. I declare it enforced in the name of Jesus. Take your seat. Many times, The thing that had been written about you, the enemy delays it because, number one, you don't understand the mystery of what is written. The Bible said, and no one could open the book, according to Revelation chapter 5. No one could open the scroll until Jesus came and opened the scroll. And the scroll there was written, the salvation of me and you, that Jesus will come to fulfill it. It is written. And you hear him say, I came in the volume of the book that is written. According to Hebrews 10, in the volume of the book that is written. You are not just a human being walking. You are a walking destiny with a volume written. And that which is written is written. Some of you are written. It's written that you will be great. But you know, the enemy, I discover by revelation, by my work with God, that a whole lot of people, the enemy saw their destiny, what is written. And when it's open, the enemy say, wow, this is too good for this person to become. And they hijack it. The enemy interrupts it. Either he hijacks it or he interrupts it, or he cannot deal with the destiny. But what it does is it stops you from coming into that destiny. Through different things, through different means, through his agents, through devices he can release to you. The Bible says we are not ignorant of the devices of the enemy. The enemy can also give you a character as what blocks your destiny. And it's just okay. As long as you continue in that kind of character, that's all. And the part of his devices is that he gives you a character, a demonic habit that is against what is written concerning you. And every day you go back to do the same thing that is against God, and every day you repent, every day you do the same thing, every day you repent, you are just moving in a cycle. You can never see your destiny. Destiny are things you must deliberately do. You must pay price. You must sacrifice. It is written. Because it is written does not mean it will stand. It is written. Somebody had to read it and enforce it. Concerning the people of Israel, Jeremiah gave a prophecy years ago. He said they will be taken in captivity to a far country in the place of Babylon. And he said that they will be there for 70 years. And the Bible said when 70 years was over, they still remained in captivity because they were ignorant of what is written about them, that this captivity will come to an end. Also ignorant that the captivity you are going through will come to an end. And some of you, the time for the captivity come, but you did not have understanding to enforce it by revelation. And the Bible said it came to pass. They wonder why Daniel was in a place of prayer and in a place to do the right thing. God can never reveal himself to you in the place where you are living anyhow. In the place where you do things that don't glorify him, God only reveals himself in his secret place. The Bible said the secrets of the Lord belongeth unto those who fear him. For you to be part of the secret of God, you must fear him. In other words, before you do anything, you must consider God. Before you do anything, you must say, God, this thing I want to do, does it align with you? Not what aligns with your fleshly desires, but what aligns with God. For you must seek the kingdom of God first and his righteousness. Then every other thing shall be added unto you. If you are not in the place of seeking first his righteousness, then no matter all the beautiful quotes you quote, one day shall be better. It will never be better. Because you are quoting it will be better, but you are not walking towards betterment. You can Say all the nice quotes. Post all the nice quotes in social media. Those quotes, they don't help anybody. Those quotes only becomes reality when somebody begins to work towards it. It's a deliberate thing. You work towards it. You don't say, oh, one day I'm going to become the owner of so many cassavas. One day I'm going to own a big farm. Meanwhile, you have not gone to farm for once. You don't farm, you are just quoting it. Say it, believe it, and that settles it. Foolish quote. You keep on saying it and keep believing it and don't do anything. You keep saying, I will prosper, I will be great. Sleep in your room every day, keep saying it. For 20 years, they will meet you dying in poverty there. Say it, believe it, enforce it. Practice it. There must be the practical part of it. It's as simple as that. You must. Praying and waiting on the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord took him to the place where it was written how many years the people would spend. And they discovered that the people of Israel were already over and they did not know. There are some of you under the sound of my voice. Your captivity has been over long time ago. But the enemy used your ignorance, your lack of not being serious, close. Tomorrow you are far away. And the enemy was supposed to end 2 years up till now. And they say, where is God? Where is God? What is written is written. He's waiting for you to enforce it. And he will buy it currency. In the place of prayer, in the place of practicality, in the middle of that which has been predetermined. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
So the enemy will see the destiny. You must understand that the Bible said that though we dwell in the flesh, we do not war. Most of our warfare, they are not carnal. The enemy gives you a habit that you say, no, I can't do. I cannot do without this. Oh, for every other thing I will try, but this one, no way. That is the assignment. You must resist the devil and they will flee. You can't keep doing the same thing again and again, living the same kind of demonic and ungodly lifestyle that makes God frown. And you say, oh, I must get there. You won't get anywhere. I promise you. For free. The Bible teaches us to work out our salvation. To work out our what? So one of the things the enemy will give to you is bad habits. Number two, he makes you an unserious person. And number three, he makes you, because we are talking about devices here, devices. That talks about strategies also. He makes you keep doing the same thing again and again, that every time you are close to your journey, he raises the habit. And that's why, listen, God will not resist the devil for us. We are the one to resist the devil. He said, you will resist the devil and they will flee. So the devil put up, even when he sees that you are overcoming all these things, that you have become deliberately a disciplined person and covenanted yourself to God, then he raises his troops and his army. And says, make sure this man doesn't get to where he's going. And by the reason of the system of the kingdom and the authority of scripture, he says, we are the one to ban. He said, whatsoever you ban on earth, in heaven you ban. I mean, will be banned. Whatsoever you set loose on earth, in heaven it will be set loose. Then the enemy makes it look as if it's difficult. Don't stop. Pray. Don't stop living righteous. Don't stop working for him. Keep working. The more the enemy tries to frustrate you, it's an indication how great the destiny is. The enemy is afraid of what is before you. He says, if I let this man go, if I let this woman go, my kingdom will be in problem. If I let this man go, what is set and written before him means he will finance the kingdom, and the kingdom of darkness, we have no chance to go forward. And it tries to frustrate you. Come with me, Genesis chapter 49. I want you to see how these things work. Genesis 49, give me verse number 19 very quickly. Genesis 49. I'm trying still to show you how destinies are written and also how the enemy can also block it and how we can also enforce it. Watch this. Go to verse 1 before you come to 19. Here was a man in the person of Jacob. Then the man said, gather my sons together. Gather my sons together Here is a father. He says, so that I will tell them what shall befall them in their last days. In other words, he said, gather my sons together. Let me show them the will I've written. Now, what we refer to today as will, in the old course of the patriarch, what is referred to is the spoken word, not today's will that can be manipulated. Now, what your father speaks over you, that is what you will become. Hear it. He said, and Jacob called his sons together. He said, gather yourself together that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last day. Man is writing. Now, go to verse 19. Many of them, he said, this you will become, this you will become, this you will become, and that you will become. But when he got to God, he said, God, a troop shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at the last. A troop shall overcome God, but he shall overcome at last. How many people wait till at last to overcome it? At last means the battle will be tough. He didn't say you will overcome in the beginning. He said, but at last you will overcome. But what will you do to overcome at last? It means everything you try to do, the enemy will put resistance. The enemy will try to frustrate you. But they that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. For you to always overcome and win at last, you must go to his presence, wait upon him, keep waiting upon him, keep praying. For they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up wings like that of eagle. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And they shall mount up wings like that of eagles. Because it will come to the time when the enemy will want to make you weary, where the enemy will want to make you faint. He said, but because you wait on him. In other words, the surest way and the consistent way to break through, to become at last what is written for you, is to continually be in his presence and do his will. Somebody shout hallelujah. Now, some of you here, you are like God. There is nothing you can do about it. Some people, their greatness started from very early in the beginning, and along the way battles came and they overcame and became greater. There is nobody in life that goes through this life without battles. No way. Nobody becomes a champion without a fight. Victory is a product of a fight. Victory is a product of a fight. Nobody becomes a champion without a fight. So you will fight and fight and fight and fight and fight again and again and again. And the Bible says, fight the good fight of faith. When you are fighting the good fight of faith, surround yourself with people who fight the same cause you fight. Surround yourself with people that are going to the same journey you are going to. Don't ever board a flight going to Mozambique, where your destination is America. You will never get to where you are going. You will miss road. So first, you need to deliberately, once you become an eagle, you fly with eagles. You don't become an eagle where you are destined for up, where you are destined to eat fresh things that you select. Then you become a vulture, start flying with vulture, and start eating dead things. What's the difference between the vulture and the eagle? Very simple. The vulture is very lazy, but the eagle fights for what he wants. The vulture looks for anything available that is dead, he eats it. But the eagle says, I want a live snake. It's dangerous, it's difficult, it's risky, but go after it. He takes it. He says, I want a fresh fish in the water. From the sky, he looks. And he said, that is my target. He comes for it, grabs it, and go. If you watch this geographical channels, this animal wildlife, you will see sometimes the eagle even attempt to carry a lion and other stuff. That's very dangerous. But in the battles of destiny, it's full of danger. Fight the good fight of faith.
I hear you, sir.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now sit down, watch this. Let me paint this for you. The father said, God. That means the father is not cursing him. It was the spirit of God that took over, declaring the future of what would befall the families. Then he said, God, in the prophetic, I see that in time to come, you will go through battle. You shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at last. So where you are is not your last. Your last place is the place of victory. It's where you have fulfilled your destiny.
Yes, sir.
Where what is written is enforced. Where what is written is confirmed.
Yes.
Where it's performed. I pray for somebody today. Anywhere they kept you, I came to move you from where the enemy put you to where you ought to be. The enemy can keep you there, but you can't remain there. They can take you there, but they can't keep you there. I don't know who took you there. It might be the power. It might be the habits, it might be the characters that the enemy have sown into you. By the power of the Holy Ghost, I release you from that place. I came to empower your destiny from where you are to where you ought to be. Somebody say, I walk into it. Now watch. Now I want you to mark this very word, troop. T-R-O-O-P, troop. Somebody say troop. All right, come with me. Let's see what happens because of time. Luke chapter 8, from verse 26. I want to show you something. Luke chapter 8 from verse number 26. And they arrive at the country of the Gadarenes. I want you to also, I told you to mark troop. I told you, I'm also telling you to mark the word Gadarenes. Now, God is the father and the one in charge of the place, the country or the city called Gadara. So it's called the gathering. I want you to also underline this. And they arrived at a country which is over against Galilee. Go ahead. And when he went forth to land, they met him out of the city a certain man, which had devils long time, and wore no clothes, neither abode in any house, but in the tombs. 28. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him, and with a loud voice said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God Most High? I beseech thee, torment me not. For he had commanded the unclean spirits to come out of the man, for oftentimes it had caught him, and he was kept bound with chains and in fetters. And he break the bands and was driven of the devil into the wilderness. And Jesus asked him, saying, what is thy name? And he said, Legion. Also mark the word Legion. Underline it. Because many devils were entered into him. And they besought him that he would not command them to go out into the deep. And there was there an herd of many swine feeding on the mountain. And they besought him that he would suffer them to enter into them. And he suffered them. Then went the devils out of the man and entered into the swine. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the lake and were choked. 34. When they that fed them saw what was done, they fled and went and told it in the city and in the country. 35. Then they went out to see what was done, and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. 36. They also which saw it told them by what means he that was possessed of the devils was healed. Then the whole multitude of the country of the Gadarenes round about besought him to depart from them, for they were taken with great fear, and they went up into the ship and returned back again. 38. Now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, go and give testimonies. Verse 39. Return to thy own house and show how great things God had done unto thee. And he went and published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. Look at this evangelism, the whole city. And you, your evangelism, not they pass your house. That's for another day. Now watch this. I told you to mark the word God, Genesis 49:19. A God, this and that shall happen to you. A troop shall trample on you, and at last you will overcome. Now, that gatherer, the seed of gatherer. Now, when that, the prophecy was not just for God, but the prophecy was also for the greatness and for the descendants of God. That community, that country, that city called Gadara. Now remember, another translation for the purpose of explanation, for the purpose of better understanding, another translation puts it clearer and calls it legion. Did your Bible say legion? Your Bible said legion? Now, the demons in that man, Jesus said, who are you? He said, we are legion. Now let me quickly explain something very well. I'm connecting the God in Genesis 49:19 to this gathering people in the book of Luke. Now look at the connection. What is the connection here? It's the same seed, the same generation, the same people. But these people have greatness. But their father saw that the enemy will fight against the greatness. When the battle becomes too much over you, every time one battle to the other, it's not because you are a bad person. You have not to be ignorant. You got to know that there is something you carry that intimidates the enemy. And the work of the enemy is to make sure that thing never manifests. So it comes with different way. That's why the Bible speaking the other day, he said, we are not ignorant of the devices of the enemy. Now, the word God, gathering, troop, legion. Listen to this carefully. So I go with the legion, then I go with the troop. Anybody who is a military person knows that the word troop is a military word. Now, what is the word troop? Another translation also says, a legion shall trample on you. Now, legion, troop, is a military language mostly used by the military. We are sending our troop. You know, they are saying they are sending their men. They are sending soldiers. Now, the word troop, then in the Roman military formation, the word they use also is legion. Now, what is the meaning of legion? Legion means a military formation where a captain presides over 6,000 soldiers. Then among the 6,000 soldiers, you have 3,000 foot soldiers and 3,000 horsemen. Now, in other words, the devil did not just send one demon after that man. The devil saw the greatness of the man and sent 6,000 demons so that the greatness of God will never come. But then it is written that God will overcome.
Yes.
Kamata yabataba. So the reason why they kept him was because of what is written, that God will finally overcome the troop. But the troop says, we are not just going to let you overcome us. And they sent 6,000 soldiers. Yes. After one man, how long will it take one man to fight 6,000 soldiers? Hey, listen, you see some people, they are delivered. One is uncle. As soon as they get up, it is grandmother that manifests. As they are delivered from that one, the next one that manifests is family altar. As they are delivered from that one, it says it's the one from mother's side. As they are delivered from that one, it says it's the one from father's house. It says it's the one from the regions of the waters. And sometimes you that don't have understanding will say, what is wrong with that person? No, you don't understand. You are ignorant. You are very ignorant. Now imagine we're in a service. I am delivering that God. And as I pray for him the first time, he said, we are 6,000, but now we are 5,999. Now, you know what it means in a destiny of a people? In a destiny of a people, what is written? The enemy said, we will not send one demon, we will not send 10, we will not send 50, we will not send 100. We will line 6,000 demons. How long will it take him to deal with one? By the time he finishes that one, another one shows up. He's fighting that one. He might not finish this battle until he dies. He might not finish it until he dies. He might not finish it until he dies. But something beautiful about the book of destiny. Now, what is written in destiny concerning you, there must have been a place of waiting, a place where somebody deliberately has called upon God, either in the present or in the past, or by the Father, or somebody interceding on your behalf. And then what happened, for any destiny to be enforced to come into manifestation, it doesn't only take the person who has the destiny, but there had to be an enforcer that will show up at some point. I don't know how many demons they sent to block you, but I came as a generational prophetic enforcer. And I came, I came to break the demonic protocols. What is written is written. The gospel. I came to enforce it. You will make way to sponsor the gospel. Yes. It is written that you will be the voice of your family. Yes. But they heard your voice burned and kept it mute. I came to open your mouth. They will hear your voice. Yes. They will hear your voice. Yes. They will hear your voice. Yes. In the name of Jesus. Yes. You are the one to take the gospel to certain land. Yes. Where people have not heard about Jesus. And the enemy saw what your impact would be by the reason of what is written. And the enemy put his formation and strategies and devices in place to block you. But a man must show up in the place and in the course of your destiny for there to be performance. I prophesy for somebody. I don't know who says I am tired. I don't know who says I have done everything I know how to do, but they will not let me go. It's an indication that what you are fighting is stronger than you. But I came as the man sent from afar to help you. Because in every book of destiny, a man from afar will show up. Yes. I came as that man from afar. Yes. I declare the demons will let you go. Yes. I take
take over the battle. I take over the battle. I take over the battle. I command the legions of your father's house, the legions of your mother's house, the legions from your place of nativity, the legions from the regions of the waters, the legions combined with the powers from the coven, the legions from the graveyard, the legions from the witch doctors, the legions from the market square, the legions from the graveyard, the legions from the road junction, the legions that came by the reason of the curse that was pronounced under the sun, under the moon, by the power of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Break out! Break out! Break out! Break out! Break free! Break free! Breakthrough! Come into your greatness! Come into your glory! Come into your destiny! I cause it to be enforced! Come into your glory! Come into your glory! It is your time! It's your season for your appointment! Arise and shine! For the light has come! Darkness may cover other nations, but upon you the glory of the Lord shall be risen, because your season of enforcement has come. Hallelujah.
Sit down. Let me finish it. We'll pray. The prophecy is for an appointed time.
Yes, sir.
According to Habakkuk chapter 2. He said, though it tarries, wait for it. You know why the word "though it tarries"? Not that the enemy can stop it, but the enemy can delay you. It's in the process of what is written in your destiny, the enemy can cause it to be delayed. But a delay is not a denier.
Yes, sir.
The reason why the enemy is causing all this turbulence in your life is because he doesn't want you to get to your destination. You are not having smooth ride. It's not because you don't know where you are going. You're not having smooth ride because the enemy says, if it happens, my kingdom will be in trouble. Now, the devil is wise, because every wise man defends his kingdom. So that's what he's doing. He knows the money in your hand will depopulate his kingdom. He knows the money in your hand can host many more crusades. He fights you. He knows you are made up of some serious stuff. And the devil tries to misrepresent you by a giveaway character that truly does not represent who you are. And many times the enemy misrepresents you because of where you are going to. And many times you are accused and you are misrepresented. People see who you are not. And the enemy manipulate them. You are black, but they see white. You are white, but they see black. Now take for instance, it has been destined by the prophetic, also written destiny and spoken destiny by Jacob, that says Joseph will become the helper of the family. But understand something, he will not just become the helper. The enemy will rise against him. He can come in different form. As soon as that destiny was written, God began to reveal it to Joseph, and God gave him it in a dream. He said, Joseph, this is what you will become. Look at these stars. And then he told his brother the dream. He said, in a dream, I saw 11 stars, including the moon and the sun. They all bowed down and worshiped me. And the brother said, what are you implying? We are 12 in number. And if 11 of us bow down to you, the star and the moon, you are saying, so we, your brothers, 11 of us, including mama and papa, we bow to you. No problem. What did the devil do? The devil made Joseph not to, he's supposed to keep it. There are destinies and there are things God revealed to you, you keep to yourself. There are things you share to people, your battle escalates. So sometimes you have to keep quiet to de-escalate these battles in your life. Because anybody can become a tool in the hand of the enemy. Someone was showing me something yesterday, a picture, and they wrote something about it, a pastor. He said, this is the popular hip-hop America, rapper, they called Tupac Shakur. Now, the people that surrounded him were all his inner circles, but they were the one that destroyed him. One of them was shown as a girl who was with him, also accused him of rape, and one of them was shown as one guy from the Haitian that used to work with him, who shot him in the studio. One of them was his manager who set him up to be shot dead. Now, sometimes the enemy also surrounds you with enemies. Let me tell you something. Now, sometimes you need to understand the complex of destiny. You need to understand what destiny is all about. It's not a day job. Life is not funfair, it's warfare. Everybody wants to outsmart everybody. Some people are not happy. Why should you be the one? Some people are not happy. Why should you be the one leading them? If they have a way, they will kill you. That even among your people you trusted, it's not bad to trust people, but there are levels of trust you keep to yourself.
Yes, sir.
And listen, what do I mean? Sometimes, majority of the time, the security man that works with me, I don't tell them in advance I'm going here. You get ready anywhere I want to go. You're supposed to go with me. I just get ready, come out. The car is ready. They are there. Okay, just go this way. When you are going, I will tell you where we are going to. It doesn't mean that I'm afraid of anything. Come this show, but don't know where you're
going. Yes, sir. I hear you, sir.
Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
So one day, one of them said, but sir, you should be telling us where we are going to. I said, is there anywhere we'll go to that you will say no? I said, is there anywhere we want to go to that you will say no? I said, you lead me to tell you where I want to go to. Leave the headache to me. Are you getting what I'm saying? There are security, but you have to also be careful. Your life should not be in the hands of anybody. By God and you should determine what you want to do, where you want to go. You should be like a wind as a man of the spirit. He said the wind, he said, you know, you hear the sound, you know what, not where it's coming from, not where it's going to. Even up to my family in the village, when we go for program, I tell them I'm going on Saturday. They see me on Thursday morning, we are preparing. We ready, we put everything ready, we are entering. And we are going. Amen, somebody. My mother says, but you said you are going on Saturday. I say, yes, something came up, we are traveling today. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
It doesn't mean I don't trust them. I trust them, but they can also tell people with evil, there are battles that are not necessary. Are you hearing me? There are
battles
you should postpone. Don't bring unnecessary battles to add to the one you are already fighting.
I hear you, sir.
Is anybody hearing me?
Yes, sir.
You should learn this. So Joseph had another dream. He said, this time around, I was in a field. I saw 12 bundles of sheep. And 11 fell, only my own was remaining. So you are confirming again. No problem. Shall we bow to you? And you stand. Then our staff fall. Your own remain. No problem. Congratulations. Well done, brother. That's good. That's awesome. That's wonderful. Wow. No, it's not their mind though, they are just saying it. But in their mind, you. Why they are saying awesome, wonderful, in their mind they say you. Let's see, you will rule over me. Thunder fire you there. Let's see, you small boy, you want to rule over me. Nobody would be alive go rule over somebody. By the time we kill you, put you one side, let's see how you will rule. That is the wickedness of the wicked people. The Bible said the heart of a man is wicked. Who can discern what is in the heart of a man? The same man who says I love you is the same man who kills you. Judas saw Jesus. He kissed Jesus. And normally somebody who kissed you should be somebody who loves you. But many people that kisses you are the same people that destroys you. So don't ever be betrayed by a kiss. Don't ever be deceived by somebody say, I love you. Don't ever be betrayed by somebody say, listen, I hate it when people say I'm loyal. I don't want to hear that word. Don't say it. Continue to prove it. Now hear me. They conspired against him. What did they do? They wanted to kill him. This one said, let's sell him. You know what happened to his destiny? That was the end of him. They sold him to slave masters. From slave master, look at the battle. The brothers planned and first there was argument. This one said, let's kill him. This one said, let's not kill him. You see the battle from his own brothers. But this we are not just his brother. This is the devil saying, how can I leave this man? He saw what is written in the predetermined counsel of Jehovah that this man will become a prime minister that will be in charge of the world economy. Do you know at the time that everywhere there was recession, everybody had to come to Egypt to buy? And who is in charge of the economy is Joseph. So Joseph can decide to buy the whole world at that time. Said and said, for me to leave this Hebrew guy who is a Christian, money in his hand, no, I will fight him. He brought the brothers, they threw him into the cistern. The cistern was to kill him. A cistern is described as a reservoir in the wilderness where they reserve water. And during dry season, it dries off. And during that period, different wild beasts, wild animals, enters there. So they put him there to die. But the destiny spoke. And the brother, this God also used his brother, they brought him out. The brother said, let's not kill him, let's sell him. They sold him and reported to the father that he was devoured by a wild beast. When he got to the palace, when he got to the house of Potiphar, he thought that finally he has come to the place of rest. Some battles will be orchestrated by God, but it looks painful. Because when you are not in your place and you are comfortable that you are in your place, God will always stir controversies. God can stir up battles in order to move you because it will bring people to bite you at your back.
Yes, sir.
And they are called backbiter. If they don't bite you at your back, you can't go forward.
Yes, sir. I hear you, sir.
Is anybody hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Somebody said, talk to me.
Talk to me, sir.
So it was very comfortable in the house of Potiphar. And God said, Joseph, this is not the place. We are just part of the journey. This is half of the journey. The journey is still far away. Don't remain here. I don't like the way you are too comfortable with the present place. This is not the place, but this is part of the plan. You know, when you are traveling, for example, maybe you are going to a place like maybe United Kingdom and you go by South Africa Airways, you have to drop. It is called transit. Your transit point, God will not allow you to remain at your transit point. He had to cause something to move you. You get too comfortable with your transit point. And he said, Joseph, this is not a deal. Joseph is not understanding. So God said, well, wife of Potiphar, get ready. I'm going to use you. It's part of the destiny. Planned destiny. And they rose the woman. The woman all of a sudden began to fall in love with a houseboy. Try to do everything. Try to seduce the guy. The guy said, I know you are very beautiful, madam. But listen, madam. In the affairs of destiny, I can't give out my precious destiny because of pleasure of 5 minutes. He said, far be it from me that I do this wicked thing against the Lord. He said, your husband put everything and put me in charge, but not including you. Ma, with all due respect, I would never do this. And it came to pass. You have to be very careful. Everything, they said, just do it, I will promote you. Just do it, I will pass you. Just do it. That 5 minutes, something has truncated your destiny for life. You begin to go around your place of destiny, but they took something from you. thing you see you call enjoyment that is sex has destroyed millions of people. Has caused great men not to enter into where they are supposed to. Has caused people not to enter. Has caused greater delay. It was a sex, just sex of one day, 5 minutes, that Judah, if you read Genesis chapter 49, the role of Judah in the destiny is to produce kings. He said, "His scepter shall not depart from Judah until Shiloh comes." The scepter means the staff of authority for kingship. He said, "Unto Judah shall the people will come to bow before him." That means it is by the written destiny and by the predetermined counsel of Elohim, confirmed and spoken by Jacob, that Judah should produce kings. Do you know what? For 500 years, they could not produce king. Because Judah, in Genesis 38, slept with a woman. Who did he sleep with? His daughter-in-law. Without even knowing it was his daughter-in-law. You know, listen, let me make something very crystal clear. You see, these things you do, apart from what it will cost you, the next generation will continue to pay because of your stupid and silly mistake. I'll show you. Watch this. For 500 years, you know what? That relationship, that illicit affair, it produced a bastard. And in Deuteronomy 23:2 or Deuteronomy 22:3, it says, "A bastard shall not come into the assembly of my people." For how many generations? 10 generations. When Judah did that, when you go to Matthew chapter 1, next time I've shown you that several times. The Bible said, when Judah begat Zerah, and who? Zerah. And Zerah and Pharez, they were the twins that came by the reason of that affair, because the lady went and dressed as a prostitute. And the man say, "Oh boy, let me just do once." Now that once, 500 years, they lost it. That's not enough. If you go to Matthew chapter 1 from verse 3, this one begat this, but they lost their right to produce kings for 500 years. 10 generation, 50 times 10 gives you 500. The Bible said, until the 10th generation, David, Jesse begat David, the king. So nothing like king came for 500 years. Somebody say amen. Now look at the thing move in the bloodline. It got to David. You know how David saw a woman, other kings were having conference. United Nations. David said, "I won't go." He started watching adult film. Then there he saw a woman beating. He said, bring me that woman. He refused to go. What happened to him? It's not him. It's the same seed the father planted that has grown. And David had to harvest from it. Not long. Look at one of the sons of David slept with the sister. Cycle of the past. History is repeating itself because one man sins. Be careful. Can I hear your amen?
Amen.
So that's why Joseph said no. He said, "Where I'm going to is important to me than the pleasure of today." He said no. He went to where I was going to. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
There are many of you that destroyed where you are going to by the foolishness of yesterday. I pray that mercy speaks for you today.
Amen.
That the enemy be stripped off of their rights to keep your destiny. Let the enemy be stripped off their rights in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And David lost it. If you go far, you will see how that family became reckless until Solomon came. The team manifested them all. 1,000 women. That's to say, if you have 365 days in a year, that means he cannot sleep with all the wives, even if it's one every day, and which is not possible. But it might be possible because he might have some strange power. Even if it's one every day, that means it takes about the space of 2 years even 3 years. 3 years. 365 times 3 gives you how many? I mean, gives you how many? 1,000 plus, right? So you what? You think about it. For close to 3 years, that's what it will take him. Every day. Hey. The enemy is wicked. But I declare that you will not lose your destiny.
Amen.
If you have made any mistake yesterday, let the blood of Jesus speak for you.
Amen.
May your mistakes and sins of yesterday not be brought against you by the enemy. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
May the iniquities of your father's house, the iniquities of your mother's house, may it be blotted out.
Amen.
May your iniquities of yesterday be blotted out.
Amen.
May your slate become clean.
Amen.
May every record against you written on your slate, let the Lord wipe it off.
Amen.
Somebody shout yes. Whether you are a young man, whether you are a young woman, whoever you are, and you say this thing you move, this thing you are doing, you call pleasure, whether you are a man or a woman, from here to there, from there to there, it is more of destruction of your destiny today and your children tomorrow. May your children not become useless on account of the rubbish you are doing. May your slate be wiped away.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So that's what the enemy will do. For Joseph to get to the palace, it was a battle. Because the enemy knew where Joseph was going to. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
But then, he said he will overcome. What is written how it will overcome? God showed it in his word in Isaiah chapter 46. How he will overcome. He said a man will come from a far country. In Isaiah 46 from verse 9, a man will come. Now for that destiny to be enforced, the enemy had already overpowered you, but a man had to come. Gadara, God was already overcome, but a man in the person of Jesus had to come to help him. In every destiny for your next level, for what is written, but a man had to sign it.
Yes, sir.
Everything that is written, we need the appendix or the signature of a man who is in the midst of the destiny. And God has given me a pen to everything that is written concerning you is written.
Yes.
By the power of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
I pen my signature in the name of Jesus. You will become what God says you will be. For what is written is written. They said to the king, why do you say this man, Jesus, is the king of the Jews? The king did not even know what he was doing. But the king, who is also the enemy of Jesus, had to append his signature. Because the king was in the midst of the destiny of Jesus. What is written is written. They said to him, this is not right. You are the king. How can you say this man is the king? The man said, I don't know where I have written. What is written is written. God has written that you will become a multi-billionaire. What is written is written. God has written that. Is this season that battle will end in your family?
Yes.
It cannot be changed. What is written is written. It is written that you are about to have your triplets, your twins.
Yes.
That miracle baby boy. And the enemy can't stop it anymore. Because what is written
is written.
What is written
is written.
Watch this, then we'll pray. He said, remember the former things of old. For I am God, and there is none else. He's trying to tell you that what I write, he said, my word that I speak will not return unto me void until it has accomplished its purpose. But it has to be for a man of a purpose, with the people of a purpose, for the mission of a purpose. Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is none else. I am God and there is none like me. One, he said, I am God, no one else. In other words, there is no other God. And he said, I am God and there is none like me in his resemblance. Then number 10, quickly. Declaring the end from the beginning. And from ancient times, the things that are not yet done. They have not been done. When many years ago, they spoke to my parents that you are going to have a son that will be used greatly by the Lord. Many years ago, I was not born. My mother had not conceived me. Now he said, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. All my pleasure. In the counsel of the Lord, his pleasure is that you will live and not die. His pleasure is that you will prosper and they will not stop you.
Amen.
His pleasure is that you will become great and nobody will pull you down.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus is written.
Amen.
Verse 11, watch this as we begin to pray. Calling a ravenous bird from the east. You know, when Elijah, in his destiny, God showed that there is a time when there will be famine. He said, but in the time of famine where everybody is suffering, because I have written my destiny, your destiny, what is written is written. When there is nobody to have a bakery that functions anymore because there is famine everywhere, no abattoir to get fresh meat because all the cows and all the livestock, they are dying because of lack of water. He said, then I will send a raven. And this ties to what happens to her. He said, calling a ravenous bird from the east. So the raven was called. Remember, the Bible said raven was feeding Elijah 2 times a day. Fresh meat, fresh bread, baked from the oven of the Lord. So for the destiny of what is written to be established, God can go extra mile. I declare, I see God going extra mile for you.
Amen.
Watch, he said, the man that executed my counsel. So in your destiny, there is a man God put that will execute it. I came as that man. Oh, not for everybody, not for everybody. I came as that man. He said, the man, he didn't say the God. No, he didn't say the God. And you will be foolish not to recognize the executor of the counsel of the Lord's destiny in your life. I am a prophetic executor.
Yes, sir.
Hey. Hold on. Now, when a rich man is to die, they write their will. They call their lawyer and they say, I want 90% of this property, this and this, to be given to this person. The person might not even be his son or his daughter. But because it's written, it has to be executed. It has to be obeyed. Now, it's not just only the lawyer. The man gets some people, maybe friends and people related. These days, they put it in record. Some people video it. And said, this and this belongs to this and this and that. So when you are arguing, they can slot in the tape and play it. Now, the lawyer comes. The lawyer is not the one that owns the property. The lawyer did not work for the property. But the man gave the lawyer the power of attorney to Ayama Tayabadaba to become an executor,
yes, sir,
of his written will in his absence. Yes. Whomever that is given, you know, Jesus says there cannot be a heir who inherits the property until the father dies. So the lawyer comes as the executor and he says, you imagine in your mind you are angry when the lawyer is reading that out. You say, you make this money, no being, but somebody transferred the power of attorney.
Yes, sir.
Recognize in law recognized in the constitution of any country, of any nation. And the lawyer says, your father said, this is my interest. My interest is that this person will have 25 buildings, and you will have only car, and you will have 1,000. It's a written destiny. You might not like the lawyer, but he's an executor.
Yes, sir.
Your enemies might not like me, but I am an executor.
Yes, sir.
God is not here, I am here.
Yes, sir.
And they sent me here to be an executor.
Yes, sir.
He said, the man that executed my counsel from a far country, yea, I have spoken it, I will also bring it to pass. I have proposed it, and I will also do it.
Yes.
I came as a prophetic executor. What is written over you, about your greatness, about your healing, about your destiny, about your fruitfulness, I prophesy, and I prophesy by the power of the Holy Ghost. I enforce it now. I enforce your greatness. I enforce your marriage. I enforce your destiny. As an executor, I execute it now, that you will become great. You will become a multi-millionaire. You will become the landowner. You will become the house owner. I execute the plan. That marriage will hold. That marriage will stand. It will hold. You will get that admission. You will graduate. You will come out of that sickness, because at last you will overcome. It's your season. You will overcome. You will overcome. I prophesy that strong man, part of the execution is that the strong man dies. I prophesy today, when it was written, God showed me. He said, when you come as an executor, he said, any man that threatens them, any woman that threatens them, any power that threatens them, he said, eliminate them. I came as a prophetic executor. I came as a generational prophet. Whatever man, whoever woman, standing against the execution, standing against the enforcement, by the power of the Holy Ghost, I command a man to die. I command a woman to die. I said die. Enter your glory. Enter your marriage. Enter your destiny. Enter your next level. Enter your glory. Be successful. Prosper. Go forward. Come out of that battle. Come out of that battle. Come out of that sickness. Come out of that delay. Come out of that battle. From ancestral battle, come out of it. From marine delay, come out of it. From the powers of your father's house, I release you. From the powers of your mother's house, I release you. From the power that says no, I say yes. The one that says over their dead body, I prophesy, let them die. Let them die. Let them die. You don't serve a dead God. You serve a living God. When the Lord shall again turn the captivity of Zion, they shall be like them that dream. Glory is on your side. Power is on your side. Miracle is on your side. Deliverance is on your side. Breakthrough is on your side. Lift up your legs and shout fire. Shout fire. Jump up and shout, yeah! Yes! Ah!
Yes!
But at last, you will overcome.
said,
at last
I will
overcome.
This is that season of at last.
Yes.
When I did a very deep study on God and the gatherings, I discovered, you know, the Bible said he went into Decapolis. The Bible said he shared the testimony in everywhere. Decapolis means a region of 10 cities. A region that consists of 10 cities. The man, when I read the history, the man became a brutal, aggressive evangelist. He planted churches in all the cities. Became a great revivalist. He single-handedly brought revival into Decapolis. Decapolis is Operation 10 Cities. He brought revival in all the cities of Decapolis. Planted churches everywhere. Delivered people. Is that not enough to make the enemy feel threatened? He knew what the man, he saw the havoc. He feared the havoc that the man would bring to his kingdom. But thank God, the word did not say at the end, the word said at last. Lift up your right hand. At last you are finally overcome. That's what I came to do. I am that executor.
Yes, sir, you are.
That's why God brought you. You are not here by mistake.
Yes.
I am the prophetic executor.
Yes, sir.
That devil is a bastard. Stop. What is written is written.
Yes.
Your victory is declared now.